Namaskar learners, I am Dr. Aman from Department of Educational Studies, Central University of Jammu. I welcome all of you in NIOS studio for the course 504. And today I'm going to have discussion on data presentation through histogram. And my presentation will be confined to some points. Firstly, we will try to describe the term histogram. Then we will try to understand what are the important steps which are helpful for the construction of a histogram. Then with the help of examples, friends, we will see a picture of the histogram, and from that picture we will see how it is drawn. Then we will also try to differentiate between bar graph and histogram. And of course, we will see different shapes of histogram and we will try to interpret each type. And lastly, we will see what are the advantages and disadvantages of using a histogram in research or in data presentation. So friends, the definition of histogram is concerned, it will be if the data is a grouped frequency distribution where the frequencies of the groups or classes with continuity are given, then there is no justification of having a gap between two successive bars. So the bars are drawn consecutively. Such a type of graph is known as histogram. So friends, this was the definition of histogram, and I have told you earlier also how we try to construct class intervals in a distribution. Then after making class intervals, so far your histogram is concerned, we have to plot frequencies in the shape of bars which will be adjacent to each other. So now we will see what are the main steps which to be taken care while we are constructing a histogram. In first step, friends, obviously we have to arrange the distribution into some class intervals. And how class intervals are made, that I have discussed in my previous lectures also. For that purpose, friends, firstly we have to calculate the range. Now the question is, if you are remembering my previous interactions, the range can be calculated after arranging a distribution in some order, suppose ascending or descending. So when the distribution is arranged, then if we are starting from lowest to the highest or ascending order, then the range can be calculated by subtracting maximum value from the minimum value. And from that range, friends, you will analyze that what would be the size of the class interval. So that is the first thing which you have to do while constructing a histogram. Then secondly, divide the range by the number of groups you want and then round up. Obviously, the groups will be in the shape of class intervals. Use the class width in the third step to create your groups. So class width, I told you just now, that will be class interval. Suppose you are taking a class interval of length 10, then the particular values coming in that class interval, that would be your particular group. So that way we create some of the class intervals and then we try to plot the frequencies. Then obviously when you are creating class intervals, then number of values lying in that particular class, that will be indicating the frequency of each group, which you have to do in fourth step. Now friends, I am showing you one example, and I have taken one distribution which is indicating the age of 20 people, and you can see it on the screen also. And this data is, you know, this is raw data. We have not arranged this data in some order. So in the next slide, what we have to do, we are arranging it in ascending order. So you can see in your slide also, how we have arranged. We have put the minimum value at the first place, that is 22, then 25, 36, 36, 38, then we are reaching up to 91. And therefrom, I have told you earlier also, you can calculate the range also, and then you can see what should be the size of your class interval. So these are 20 students, 20 people whose age we are going to see. Then friends, we have made this table also. You can see in the slide that we have made some class intervals like 20 to 30, 30 to 40, and likewise we are reaching from 90 to 100. So in second column we have put up the frequency, and I have written the scores also in the third column, which indicate that in the first class interval 25 and 22 are coming within 20 to 30. So obviously frequency is 2, because there are two values which are occurring in this particular class interval. Similarly friends, if you see a class interval of 50 to 60, so under 50 to 60 from the previous distribution, we can observe that there will be 5 values. That means 55, 55, 52, 58, and again 55. So we are writing frequency as 5 for the class interval 50 to 60. So that way we go on doing the same thing. 80 to 90, there will be no, that also you have to write. That is more important. While you have to draw the histogram, you cannot jump any class interval. So that is the condition which is to be taken care by the learner or the teachers. So in 90 to 100, there is only one value in the distribution, that is 91. And obviously the frequency against that we have written as 1. Now friends, we have plotted in relation to those class intervals one picture of the histogram, which is indicating the age of some people. So what we have written in the bottom, in the axis, the horizontal line is x-axis, as I have discussed in my previous interactions also, and vertical is the frequency. So obviously our class interval is starting from 20 to 30, that we have written in the horizontal line. So in 20 to 30, we have seen in the previous example or table that there were only 2 values. So frequency was 2. So we are extending, we are making 1 point at 20. Okay. Then obviously 30 to 40, there are 5 or 4 as the number of frequencies. So what we have to do friends, in 20 to 30 at point 2, which is vertical, from that point we are dropping a perpendicular on 20. Then what we have done, we are also plotting 30 to 40 line, which will be in relation to 4 frequencies. So from 4 we are again dropping the perpendicular. Now friends, for 20 to 30, again we have to drop one perpendicular, which will be horizontal. So from 2 to the, which will be touching the line of class interval 30 to 40. So similarly friends, we will be creating or we will be plotting all the values in the shape of bars. So this is how we can construct a histogram. Now friends, as I told you earlier, while choosing class intervals, you have to be over careful. If you will not be over careful, then you can see these two pictures, what will be happening in your histogram. Look, in first picture, class intervals are too small, you can watch, and frequency is going from 1 to 3, okay, and class intervals 20 to 30. So 20 to 30 we have written in the bottom. In relation to particular class intervals, when we are plotting bar chart, when class interval they have taken so small, this is not the scale which is visible, but class interval would be round about 21 to 22 likewise. So against that they have plotted the graph. So you see, What is the disadvantage? This is not giving you clear picture of the distribution. The main purpose of drawing histogram is that we have some idea in relation to the distribution, what kind of distribution actually it is. So which I will discuss in the coming slides, what is the shape and how we can interpret that shape of the distribution through histogram. In the second picture you are watching, they have taken a bit larger class intervals, and when they have plotted the frequency in relation to that, it is also looking odd, and again it will not be giving the clear picture of the distribution. Obviously it will be consuming more space also in your scale, so again it will not be beneficial. So you have to be very careful. Your class interval shouldn't be too small and shouldn't be too large. So friends, again continuing with this interaction, I would like to say that histograms are based on area, not height of bars. In a histogram, it is the area of the bar that indicates the frequency of occurrences of each class interval. This means that the height of the bar does not necessarily indicate how many occurrences of scores there were within each individual in that particular class interval. So that's why we would be watching it as area, not as the frequency or height of the bar. And of course, it is the product of height multiplied by the width of the class interval that indicates the frequency of occurrences within that class interval. That's why it is important in histogram we have to consider whole area. One of the reason that the height of the bar is often incorrectly assessed as indicating frequency and not the area of the bar is due to the fact that a lot of histograms often have equally spaced bars, and under these circumstances the height of the class interval does not reflect the frequency. Now friends, the question is, when are histograms used? So what would be the main situations, friends, when we have to use it as a tool for the representation of data? So firstly, it summarizes large data set graphically. As we have seen in our examples also, if you are having huge distributions, the values may be going in thousands, then you can have those values within certain class intervals. You can plot the frequency in relation to that, and you can easily see what is the shape of your distribution. Compare measurements to specifications. This happens when we try to compare the different measurements, we will be coming to conclusions that what kind of product or what would be the outcome we will be coming with. So it is helpful in that sense also. Then communicate information to the team. So again, if you are plotting any information graphically, obviously regarding whole distribution, immediately you can communicate your idea to the team that this is the situation in this class interval. A teacher can make for example histogram of his subject where the students have achieved some scores, so they can see what is the level, what kind of distribution of score there is in a particular subject of his students, and obviously that thing will be assisting him in decision making also. In big companies also, the bureaucrats also, they sometimes use histograms. So it help us to make some decisions in particular situations. A teacher can also use histogram, and he can use it to make his teaching more effective, because he will be in a position to take decisions immediately, what kind of things to be given to the students, what remedial measures he or she has to take to improve his teaching. Now friends, in my previous interactions, what we have done, we have tried to discuss many other topics like frequency distribution, data representation, and also I have discussed bar graphs in my previous interactions. Now the question is, what is the difference between a histogram and a bar graph. So firstly, I would be coming to the second point. They are different from each other in the way they are to be drawn. So we have seen in bar graphs, if you see any kind of bar graph, you will see that the bars are plotted separately. There is distance between one bar and the second bar. But in histogram, you have seen right now in the examples, they are just joining or they are just stick to each other, adjacent to each other. So first difference. And friends, in the bar graphs are mainly used when the data will be in the shape of some categories. Suppose male, female, rural, urban. If data you are getting some measurement of that data in the shape of the category, then obviously bar graph will be more helpful. So for your continuous, and histogram is to be used when the data will be continuous. And continuous data is which is to be taken with the help of some measurements. As I just quoted that you can have some academic achievement scores of the students of a particular class. So that you have measured by conducting some examination. We collect data with the help of some psychological tools also. So that what we are coming up with, that would be continuous data. And in research also, friends, we used to prefer histogram when we are having this type of data. So hope you understood what is the difference between bar graph and histogram. Now friends, I'm going to take up or discuss the shapes of histogram. So while you are plotting a histogram, your distribution can be reflected or giving you different shapes. In one distribution, the shape will be different, and in the other, the shape will be different. Now friends, in the first picture, you can watch in the screen also that this kind of shape, if you see it properly, it is in the shape of bell-shaped. That's why I've written number one is bell-shaped and usually present a normal distribution. So this is a topic, friends, in the social science research, that is normal distribution. But you can read about normal distribution in detail, but I'm just giving you the idea what actually it is. Actually, friends, when we calculate data from a population and when we are working on human beings, we are taking some data from human beings. So that kind of data, because you see in population, average number of people are more there. And as a teacher, when you see in your class, you cannot say that all the students in your class are intelligent. They will be maybe 5, maybe 4, maybe 7 in number. And similarly, some students will be morons also. That means whose achievement level will be very low. They may also be 2, 3, 4, 5 or 6 or 8 in number. Rest of the students will be coming as average students. So far when we deal with human beings, we come to conclusion that average population is much more than the extremes. So that's why we take, you see this well shaped, the middle or the middle of the central area of this bell shaped histogram or the curve we are coming up with, that is indicating maximum number of frequency, because maximum number of values will be lying in the center. So such kind of distribution is called normal distribution. Now I will show you the next shape. Now friends, you must have studied mod also, mean, median, mod in your small classes, or you will be teaching in schools also, 7th, 8th standard, 9th standard, there are some topics that is mean, median, mod. So what is actually mod? That is the mod is the maximum number of time when a score is occurring, that value we call the mod. So sometimes we are having such distributions where two mod may be there, that the maximum number of time occurring value, that will be maybe 5 will be occurring 4 times. Similarly, 7 may also be occurring 4 times. So such kind of distribution we call it bimodal. So obviously that how we will be plotting that distribution. So if you plot that one, I think this will be the shape of that particular distribution, and this is called bimodal distribution. So while you are plotting your data, you can get this shape also, and you can interpret what is the situation, what is happening. From this picture, you can analyze various things, achievement level, other traits of the students also. So friends, now picture number 3 you are watching on the screen, what is it? This kind of distribution, if you are coming up with, this would be skewed right. So skewness is also one of the term which we use in statistics. Skewness means the departure from the symmetry. So when in normal distribution, as I show you, it is bell shaped. If it is skewed, if tail is coming to the right side of the distribution and the main volume is going to the left, then this kind of distribution, friends, we call it skewed to the right. Some histograms will show skewed distribution to the right, as we have shown in the figure. A distribution skewed to be right is said to be positively skewed. This kind of distribution has a large number of occurrences in the lower value cells, that is left side, as I just explained, and few in the upper value cells. A skewed distribution can result when data is gathered from a system which has a boundary such as 0. In other words, all the collected data has values greater than 0. Now friends, opposite to it, the fourth shape you can get is skewed to the left. So it is opposite to the skewed to the right. So here the tail is towards left side and departure is to the right. So in this case, or if you are getting such kind of distribution, this you will be calling as skewed to the left. And in some histograms, they will show a skewed distribution to the left, as I just show you in the picture. A distribution skewed to the left is said to be negatively skewed. This kind of distribution has a large number of occurrences in the upper value cells, that is to the right side, and few in the lower value cells, that is to the left side. That's why the frequency is minimum to the left side. A skewed distribution can result when data is gathered from a system with a boundary such as 100. In other words, all the collected data has value less than 100. And friends, you can get this shape also, and this shape you are seeing, there are very few ups and downs. So if such kind of information is coming to you in the shape of this graph, such type of histogram will be called the uniform histogram. And in such distribution, it provides little information about the system. You are getting nothing. Everything is equal. So what you will be going to interpret in such kind of distribution? For example, would be a state lottery in which each class has about the same number of elements. It may describe a distribution which has several mods or peaks. If your histogram has this shape, check to see if several sources of variation have been combined. If so, analyze them separately. Now friends, the picture you're watching, this is called random distribution. Sometimes you will be observing some ups, some downs, again ups, again downs, again ups and again downs. So this is the example of, if you are getting such type of shape, this would you may call it as random type of distribution or histogram. It has no apparent pattern like the uniform distribution. It may describe a distribution that has several mods or peaks. If your histogram has this shape, check to see if several sources of, again, as I discussed in the previous slide, several sources of variations have been combined. So again, you have to, if this is the situation, then obviously you have to analyze them separately. Now friends, what are the main advantages or limitations of using a histogram? obviously the children are more attracted to the pictures than to the, you know, properly written material. So these things provide a very visually strong image in the minds of the observer. If you are showing your data to your colleagues, obviously they will be understanding the phenomena easily. If a teacher showing the achievement level of his class to his principal or head of the institution, obviously head will be in a position to observe that immediately instead of watching each and every score in the distribution separately. So visually it is making that distribution very, very strong. Then you can compare to the normal curve also. As I just told you, there are different, you may get different shape or shapes of your distribution. So you can compare it with normality. That normality is to be skewed or shifting, or you are getting random. So you can analyze some of the distribution by comparing that with normal curve. Usually vertical axis is a frequency count of the items and falling in each category. So you can easily watch what are the frequencies in that particular distribution also. Now we are coming to the disadvantages. So friends, again, I discussed with you people in bar graph also, it same is happening here. Histogram cannot read exact values because data is grouped into categories. And it is more difficult to compare two data sets. So sometimes if you want to compare two distributions, so with the help of histogram, it would be a bit, you will be in difficulty to compare that data. In bar graphs, you can compare. You have seen in the previous interaction also. And I just told you that histogram can only be used with continuous data. If your data is in the form of some order, or if it is in the shape of certain categories, then friends, you cannot use histogram. So these were the disadvantages of using a histogram. Now to summarize this whole interaction, friends, what we discussed, we have tried to describe the term histogram, what actually it is. Then we came across the various steps which are helpful for the construction of histogram. Hope you better understood those steps. Then we also tried to construct how to construct a histogram and how that can be interpreted. Then friends, we tried to differentiate between bar graph and histogram also. Then we tried to classify various shapes of histogram also. Then in the last, we tried to discuss the various advantages of using histogram and of course disadvantages of using histogram. So with these words, I thank you all of you learners. Namaskar, Jai Hind.